Hello everyone, I am Dr. Prashant and in this presentation we will be talking about the arterial pulse. The arterial pulse is a wave that is produced by cardiac systole traversing in the peripheral direction in the arterial tree at a rate faster than the column of blood. Here we see at the onset of ventricular systole a wave being produced in the arteries which is transmitted in the arteries. This peripherally transversing wave is felt as the arterial pulse with these three fingers. This is the normal pulse waveform and can look complicated at first sight. However, it is quite simple once we think about it. This is the percussion wave. This is the tidal wave. This is called the dicrotic wave and that forms the dicrotic notch. And this is important because we will compare the normal pulse waveform against abnormal types later in this presentation. The peripheral pulses that we can palpate are the radial, the brachial, the carotid, popliteal, femoral, posterior tibial, and dorsalis pedis. For the purposes of discussion, the brachial artery is best suited for contour, volume, and consistency. However, we rarely see brachial artery being used for this purpose. The peripheral pulses can be studied under the following headings: the rate, rhythm, character, volume, condition of the vessel wall, equality or unequality of radial pulses on both sides, and a radiofemoral delay. Let us take a look at the rate of the pulse. The normal pulse rate ranges between 60 and 100 beats per minute, but this varies with age in that an infant at 1 week of age will have a pulse rate of 140 per minute, a child at a rate of 120 per minute, and at puberty this reduces to between 72 to 80 beats per minute. The abnormalities of rate can be tachycardia, which is a heart rate of more than 100 beats per minute, and this can be either in sinus rhythm or a tachyarrhythmia. What this means is that sinus rhythm is when each QRS on the ECG is preceded by a P wave. This is a complicated way of saying that in sinus rhythm, the impulse originates in the sinus node, travels to the AV node from where it reaches the left ventricle through the His and Purkinje fibers. However, in tachyarrhythmia, this chain of command is not followed. Abnormalities of rate may also include bradycardia, which is heart rate less than 60 beats per minute. And again, this can be either in sinus rhythm, in that each QRS complex on the ECG is preceded by a P wave, or it can be a bradyarrhythmia. Both these conditions can either be physiological or pathological. The abnormalities of rate, as already discussed, can be tachycardia in sinus rhythm. And the physiological causes of tachycardia in sinus rhythm are in infancy and early childhood due to exercise, excitement, anxiety, and emotional stress. The causes of tachycardia in sinus rhythm which are pathological are cardiovascular causes such as congestive heart failure, acute myocardial infarction, pulmonary thromboembolism, myocarditis, and/or shock. The non-cardiac causes include fever, anemia, pregnancy, thyrotoxicosis, Paget's disease, beriberi, hemorrhage, and hypotension. Tachycardia, which is in sinus rhythm and is due to drugs, can be because of epinephrine, isoproterenol, ephedrine, alcohol, nicotine, and caffeine. We'll now move on to the bradycardia as shown by these dots, which indicate a pulse, in this case being slow. The physiological causes of bradycardia in sinus rhythm include athletes who undergo training and during sleep. Pharmacological causes of bradycardia include beta blockers, amiodarone, antiarrhythmic drug propafenone, and the antimanic drug lithium. Bradycardia in sinus rhythm, which is pathological, can be due to cardiovascular causes such as an inferior wall myocardial infarction, a sinoatrial block, and in patients who have just undergone a cardiac transplantation. There could also be non-cardiac cause for bradycardia, and these include myxedema, Chagas disease, hypothermia, and depression. Let us now proceed to look at abnormalities of rhythm. And these include a regularly irregular pulse, in which case it is because of sinus arrhythmia or pulsus bigeminus, or it can be because of pulsus alternans or heart block. There can also be an irregularly irregular pulse, and this is most commonly due to atrial fibrillation, but it can also be because of multifocal atrial tachycardia and frequent premature ventricular complexes. Let us now talk about the character of the pulse. This historically was a toy which was used in ancient times. This is called a water hammer. What this is a piece of glass with water inside it. The rest of the air has been evacuated out to create a vacuum. Now, when this toy was turned in a particular direction, the water would rush from one side to the other, hitting the bulb and causing a sound, and this was known as a water hammer. Now, the water hammer pulse in clinical practice is due to aortic runoff, one of the reasons being aortic runoff, and this is most commonly because of aortic regurgitation, a patent ductus arteriosus, an aortopulmonary window, or the rupture of sinus of Valsalva. It can also be because of a cyanotic congenital heart disease, and in this category we have truncus arteriosus, pulmonary atresia with bronchopulmonary collaterals, and tetralogy of Fallot with a Blalock Tausig shunt. We now move on to the twice beating pulse. The types are anacrotic pulse, which is most commonly due to aortic stenosis, a bisferiens pulse, which is because of aortic regurgitation, and hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, or aortic regurgitation and aortic stenosis, but can also be caused due to hyperkinetic circulatory states and patent ductus arteriosus. We will see the pulse waveform for bisferiens pulse later. There could also be dicrotic pulse, and this is caused due to enteric fever, cardiomyopathy, hypovolemic shock, and intra-arterial balloon counterpulsation, or IABP. As we have already discussed, this is the normal pulse waveform with its percussion wave, the tidal wave, the dicrotic notch, and the dicrotic wave. Let us now compare this normal pulse waveform with other pathological types. This is the normal bisferiens pulse. We see that there are two peaks before the dicrotic notch. As we have already discussed, bisferiens pulse is caused because of aortic regurgitation, severe aortic regurgitation and aortic stenosis, or due to hyperkinetic circulatory states. The next pulse is the bisferiens pulse of hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy, and in this, the first peak is taller, whereas the second peak is shorter. Please keep in mind that the pulse waveform in bisferiens is unique because both the peaks come before the dicrotic notch. The third type is the dicrotic pulse, as we have already seen, and in this there are two peaks, but the second peak coincides with the dicrotic notch, and the causes we have already discussed are enteric fever and cardiomyopathy. This is pulsus alternans. As we can see, there is variation in the left ventricular outflow volume, thereby causing a large wave, which is because of a lot of volume being injected from the heart, and a small wave with less volume being ejected from the heart as a result of left ventricular failure. As a result, the pulse waveform alternates between small and large, giving it the name pulsus alternans. Let us now move on to discuss pulsus paradoxus. In normal individuals, when they take a deep breath, there is a fall in BP. However, in pulsus paradoxus, on inspiration, this normal fall of the BP is exaggerated, in that pulsus paradoxus is defined as exaggeration of a systolic fall of blood pressure by more than 10 millimeters of mercury. Let's see why this happens. On deep inspiration, there is pulmonary vascular pooling because the size of the thoracic cage is increased and venous return to the heart increases. Now, there is reduced intrapericardial pressure in the heart, which increases the right ventricular transmural pressure. As a result, there is increased right atrial and right ventricular filling pressure. Increased right ventricular volume and size ensues. This reduces the left ventricular transmural pressure, and we will see through a diagram what happens in pulsus paradoxus. And this reduces the left ventricular filling, which results in reduced ventricular dimensions and compliance, causes left ventricular compression, and there is left shift of the interventricular septum. Let us orient ourselves with this diagram. This is the right atrium, this is the left atrium, this is the left ventricle, this is the right ventricle. On deep inspiration, in a patient with tamponade, as shown with this yellow fluid, on deep inspiration, there is increased flow to the right side of the heart. There is also pressure from the outside, resulting in increased ventricular transmural pressures. There is shift of the septum from the right to the left to accommodate this increased blood volume. Now, the left ventricle becomes smaller because the interventricular septum is pushed towards the left ventricle. This results in an exaggerated fall of systolic blood pressure. Let us review that once again. On deep inspiration, there is increased venous return to the heart. The pressure from outside also increases transmural ventricular pressures. There is shift of the interventricular septum, thereby compressing the left ventricle, thereby reducing blood pressure. Pulsus paradoxus may be because of cardiovascular causes such as tamponade and effusive constrictive pericarditis, restrictive cardiomyopathy, massive pulmonary embolism, and severe hypovolemic shock. Pulmonary causes include chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. An absence of pulsus paradoxus when tamponade is present in atrial septal defect. What this means is, although there is cardiac tamponade, there won't be pulsus paradoxus because of the septal defect, which equalizes pressures on both sides. The types of pulsus paradoxus include total paradox, and this is because of severe cardiac tamponade, or it can be reversed pulsus paradoxus, which is because of ventilators, isorhythmic AV dissociation, or hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. Reverse pulsus paradoxus means there is increased blood pressure during deep inspiration, and this is seen rarely. As already mentioned, the causes are HOCM, isorhythmic AV dissociation, and patients on ventilators. Let us now take a look at the volume of the pulse. This can be pulsus parvus et tardus, which simply means a delayed systolic peaking in a slow rising pulse, and this is caused because of aortic stenosis. There can be pulsus magnus, which is caused because of aortic regurgitation, or there can be hyperdynamic states such as pregnancy, thyrotoxicosis, beriberi, fever, or Paget's disease, which can cause a high volume pulse. Radial pulse synchronicity is an important finding in clinical examination. Essentially, what we're doing is looking for synchronicity between the right and the left radial pulse. This can be abnormal in conditions like Takayasu's arthritis, thoracic outlet syndrome, subclavian steel syndrome, chronic atherosclerosis, coarctation of aorta, and dissection of aorta. The condition of the vessel wall is important in the elderly because in the elderly it becomes rigid and cord-like and can occur in atherosclerosis or Mönckeberg's degeneration. Let us now take a look at the characteristic pulse in certain valvular heart diseases. In aortic stenosis, there is pulsus parvus et tardus, which is slow rising pulse with a delayed systolic peaking. The patient may also have anacrotic pulse as already described. There can be pulsus alternans if a patient with aortic stenosis develops left ventricular failure, and there can also be pulsus bisferiens in severe aortic stenosis. In aortic regurgitation, there can be a water hammer pulse, there can be pulsus bisferiens or pulsus magnus. What is more important in aortic regurgitation is the pulse pressure, and it is characterized by a wide pulse pressure of more than 70 millimeters of mercury. Hill's sign, as we will see in a moment, is positive, and pulsus magnus, as we have already seen. Hill's sign is because of greater velocity of blood flow in the lower limbs and a greater gradient between the posterior tibial and the radial arteries. Hill's sign is used for the severity of aortic regurgitation. Hill sign is a gradient between the posterior tibial and the radial artery of more than 60 millimeters of mercury is called severe aortic regurgitation, or indicates severe AR. A gradient of 40 to 60 between the lower limb and the upper limb indicates moderate AR, and a gradient of 20 to 40 millimeters of mercury indicates mild AR. Also, in aortic regurgitation, there can be alternative dilatation and constriction of the pupil, and this is called Landolfi's sign. There can also be retinal artery pulsations, and this is called Becker's sign. Alfred de Musset was a French philosopher who had this habit of synchronous nodding of his head, and this was synchronicity with his heartbeat. This sign is called the de Musset sign. The signs of aortic regurgitation in head and neck include the Corrigan's sign, which is essentially a dancing carotid pulsation, the Muller sign, which is pulsation of the uvula, Minervini's sign, which is pulsation of the tongue, and Logue sign, which is pulsation of the sternoclavicular joint. The signs of aortic regurgitation in the upper extremity include locomotor brachialis, which is dancing brachial pulsations, the Quincke's pulse, which is pulsation of the nail bed, and Palfrey's sign, which is a pistol shot heard over the radial artery. This is done with a stethoscope. The signs of aortic regurgitation in the lower extremity include the Traub sign, which is pistol shots over the femoral artery, as opposed to the Palfrey's sign, which is pistol shot over the radial artery. There is also a Durosius murmur, which is characterized by the 3 Ds. And let us take a look in detail what these 3 Ds mean. The 3D of Durosius murmur in aortic regurgitation is as follows. This is a femoral artery, this is the head end, this is the foot end. On placing the stethoscope in an inclined fashion, with the incline towards the foot end, that is, it is placed distally, the patient will have a diastolic murmur. A systolic murmur would be normal because we are obstructing the artery with our stethoscope. However, if this murmur is also present in the diastolic phase, then this is called the Durosius murmur, which is pathological. Remember the 3 Ds, Durosius, distal, and diastolic. There can also be pulsation of the liver, which is called the Rosenbach sign, or there can be pulsation of the spleen, which is called the Gerhardt sign. The signs of aortic regurgitation in the abdomen are the Rosenbach sign, the Gerhardt sign, and the Denison's sign, which is pulsation of the cervix. That's it for our video on arterial pulse. Thanks for watching, and we will see you in the next video.